A very good morning to all the esteemed professors and learned members of the IEEE, respected HODs, faculty members and my fellow mates. I, Harneet Narula of BTech in Electrical and Electronics, 7th semester, welcome you all to the second lecture of the Technical Lecture Series, organized from 18th September 2021 to 26th September 2021 by the IEEE student branch of Amity University, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow campus, under the supervised guidance of Dr. Kamlesh Kumar Singh Sir, Assistant Professor and Student Branch Counselor, IEEE, Amity University, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow campus, in collaboration with IEEE Young Professionals Committee UP section and IEEE BTKITS SBC's Dwarhat. This technical lecture series is being supported by IEEE Region 10 and IEEE Young Professionals Region 10. We also have with us Dr. Varun Kakkar Sir, Chair IEEE Young Professionals UP section. The lecture titled Metasurfaces from Basics to Advanced Applications will be taken by Dr. Soman Bhattacharya Sir, Assistant Professor in the Department of Electronics Engineering at Indian Institute of Technology, Banaras, the Banaras Hindu University. Sir has thrice been conferred with the prestigious Young Scientist Award by the International Union of Radio Sciences for his insightful work.
You can start the
event. So with your permission and the permission of all the esteemed members.
Yes, please.
A very good morning to all the esteemed professors and learned members of the IEEE, respected HODs, faculty members, and my fellow meets. On behalf of the IEEE student branch at Amity University, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow campus, I, Harneet Narula, of BTech in Electrical and Electronics, 7th semester, welcome you all to the technical lecture series organized under the supervised guidance of Dr. K.K. Singh Sir, Assistant Professor and Student Branch Counselor of IEEE, Amity University, Uttar Pradesh, Lucknow campus, supported by the IEEE Region 10 and IEEE Young Professionals Region 10. Now, may I request Dr. K.K. Singh Sir to please address the audience.
Thank you, Varni. I welcome all the distinguished guests from India and from abroad, Dr. Saifur Rahman Sahab, Dr. J.S. Siddiqui Sahab. Welcome to this technical lecture series. And today we have Dr. Somak Bhattacharya, a renowned academician and a scientist from IIT BHU. And we are honored to have Dr. Bhattacharya as a speaker. Dr. Bhattacharya, who has done his PhD from IIT Kanpur, is assistant professor in Department of Electronics Engineering, IIT BHU. And he has received the prestigious Young Scientist Award from International Union of Radio Sciences three times. He's also a coordinator of IEEE Region 10 in Young Professional Group of MTT Society. Sir, we are honored to have you on this board. I welcome you on the behalf of MIT University and on the behalf of Young Professionals Committee, UP section. Ani, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. An investment in knowledge pays the best interest. Dr. Somak Bhattacharya Sir received his honours in physics from Scottish Church College in 2003 from Kolkata. Sir received his bachelor's in technology and subsequently his master's in technology from the Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics from the University of Calcutta in 2006 and 2008 respectively, with his thesis in giant meter wave radio telescope from his M.Tech from the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. Sir was the recipient of the University Gold Medal in M.Tech with more than 40 fundamental research international journals and 90 reputed peer-reviewed international and National Conference Proceedings, Sir has received the prestigious Young Scientist Award from the International Union of Radio Sciences not once but thrice in 2013 in the Electromagnetic Theory Symposium in Hiroshima, in 2015 in Regional Radio Science Conference in New Delhi, and 2016 in Asia Pacific Radio Science Conference in Seoul. Sir has been spreading the light of his knowledge as the assistant professor in the Department of Electronics Engineering at the Indian Institute of Technology, the Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi. Sir has been conferred with the honorary lifetime membership by URSI owing to his contributions in the area of radio sciences. Dr. Bhattacharya is an IEEE senior member and has not only been elected as the Life Fellow of the Optical Society of India, but also the Associate Fellow of West Bengal Academy of Science and Technology, along with the Fellow of IETE. Since 2021, Sir is serving as the coordinator of the IEEE Region 10 in the Young Professional Group of the MTT Society. In his lecture today on Metasurfaces from Basics to Advanced Applications, Sir will be talking about the basics of metasurfaces, emphasizing upon its potential applications in high-frequency regions. The requirement of high bandwidth is an utmost criterion for modern-day communication systems, which can be achieved by compact metasurface designs. Sir will also be focusing on the use of suitable materials in the metasurface designs, which can make it tunable and controllable in nature, as well as achieving multifunctionalities. With this, may I request Sir to please address the audience with his technical lecture. Sir?
Okay. So thank you, Harnit, for this wonderful introduction. I don't know how much I deserve among those. So let me try to just make it in the full screen. Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay, I am going to full screen mode. Just let me know once you can see it. Can you see
it? Yes, I can see it.
Yeah, just 1 minute. Yeah. Okay, so good afternoon, sorry, good morning to all of you from India. And since I am this many people are there from international arena also. So so thanks. And it's my pleasure and honor to accept the invitation and talk you about my researches on metasurfaces from basics to advanced applications. So to start with, let me just give you a brief recap of what high frequency we talk about. With the high frequency, we basically quantify into two regions. One is the microwave range, another one is the optical range, covering all the three bands of, the infrared or IR, or this one as visible, or you can have the ultraviolet range or UV. Can you see my writing in this board?
Yes, sir.
It is
okay.
Thank you. So what we are having, that you can see that here the microwave range, if you consider, it basically lies between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz, that is between 1 meter to 1 millimeter, if you convert into the wavelength scale. However, that for all our conventional users of microwave frequency ranges, we can consider it from 1 to 40 gigahertz, over which you can consider the millimeter wave band that comes into the picture. The millimeter wave comes into the picture from 30 to 300 gigahertz, and some of the people also call it between 40 to 300 gigahertz, where the operating wavelength is between 1 millimeter to 10 millimeter or 1 centimeter. Okay. Now, in between the two, if you note that this is 300 gigahertz or 0.3 terahertz, and this is 30 terahertz, in between the two, we are having a terahertz gap or terahertz window lying between 0.3 to 30 terahertz. I will come to some of the potential applications of this terahertz very soon. In fact, in this talk that gradually I will tell, I am not telling it right now. Okay. Now, thing is that why we are going with high frequency, that the Carson's rule that defines that one your carrier frequency or one your FC that goes up, that leads to the bandwidth requirement that basically goes up at something around 10% of the area at 10% of FC, let me write like this way. And what will happen that accordingly the channel capacity, which is basically related to bandwidth, like C equal to B log to 1 plus SNR, as you already know from Shannon law. So what will happen if the signal to noise ratio remains constant? So as the bandwidth shoots up, so the channel capacity goes up. That means your the number of channels that can be accommodated over a particular medium, that basically goes up. And hence people opted for more and more higher frequencies for communication purposes. Okay, the other purposes are already being satisfied, like the modulation use and other ones. I'm not going into much details. Okay, now let me tell you that a brief history of this wireless one. Many of you perhaps know, but since most of you are the students, I am just briefly recapping this history. So already you know that these three pioneers that in this particular field, that Sir Heinrich Hertz, that after which the frequency unit has been named, and then our own from the Indian Jagadish Chandra Bose, that who has done a magnificent work in this you know that in this field of wireless communication, where he had demonstrated successfully the short distance communication at 60 gigahertz. And also the Marconi, that who has basically has demonstrated the you know that long distance wireless communication, and due to which he has bagged Nobel Prize later in 1920s. So let me just show you that the demonstration of this wireless. So first let me focus on the right hand side. This is the, in fact you can see the towers which has been used by Marconi for the transatlantic communication between England to Newfoundland, that is the two ends of Atlantic Ocean. Whereas over here you can see that in 1897, Jagadish Chandra Bose, who had carried out his research in Kolkata or erstwhile Calcutta, I should say, that in Presidency College Calcutta, as well as you know that nowadays known as the Bose Institute in Kolkata, that here he has conducted this particular experiment. And let me tell you that whatever he has done, he had made everything, whatever we are calling nowadays as Make in India program. So you know that all the items he has procured himself, it is not procured from outside. He has developed in the lab, and accordingly he has used. Okay, like the Galena semiconductor as foot as detector and so on. Okay, so let me tell you that here he is basically demonstrating his experiment in the Royal Institution, London. If you just recall the time frame in 1897, that time India was not independent. Okay. But still, means you just think of that his legacy of his work, that that British Raj had invited him over there in the prestigious Royal Institution to showcase his research. Exactly 100 years time frame from this one, you can notice the 1997. I am just making a snapshot from a conference paper. You note the timing, 1997 IEEE MTDS International Microwave Symposium, considered as the largest gathering of this particular microwave society conference from the IEEE. And here you notice, if you note it very carefully, that if you see the title of this presentation, it is known as the work of Jagadish Chandra Bose, 100 years of millimeter wave research. And if you read the abstract, just 100 years ago, J.C. Bose described to the Royal Institution in London his research carried out in Calcutta at millimeter wavelengths. He used waveguides, horn antennas, dielectric lenses, various polarizers, and even semiconductors at frequencies as high as 60 gigahertz. Some concepts from his original 1897 papers have been incorporated into a new 1.3 millimeter multibeam receiver now in use on the NRAO 12 meter telescope. Just to think of his legacy long back. And just after 15 years from this time frame onwards, you can say that, well, this is a newspaper cutting from Kolkata in the Sunday Times, in the Times of India. You can see this headline, US agency is nothing but IEEE, which honors the works of J.C. Bose and C.V. Raman. So these are the first two milestones backed by India from IEEE. And in fact, you can see that what has been written over here, the plaque which has been handed over to the authority, you can see that first millimeter wave communications experiment by J.C. Bose between 1894 to 1896, Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose in 1895 first demonstrated at Presidency College, Calcutta, India, transmission and reception of electromagnetic waves at 60 gigahertz over a distance of 23 meters through two intervening walls by remotely ringing a bell and detonating gunpowder. For this communication system, Bose developed entire millimeter wave components such as a spark transmitter, coherent dielectric lens, polarizers, horn antennas, and cylindrical diflection grating. Okay. Now, so these are the, in fact, some of the, you know, that some of the milestones which he has achieved. Let me go back to the previous slide once again. Yeah. So if you see over here that I have made several applications in the microwave range, like mobile, satellite, these are the well-known one. But third one is a bit uncommon. In fact, not uncommon, I should say that, but students are not well aware of that one. I will discuss a very few things over that one before I enter into the more technical one. So here, basically, we are talking of the radio astronomy. So if you consider the opacity of the atmosphere, okay, what you can see that, well, you can have some kind of transparency in the optical range, okay, or in the visible range. And here, you can have some kind of wider spectrum or wider window that is available in the radio wavelengths or in the microwave wavelengths, okay. So basically, one can study the universe, okay, in the microwave wavelength. So if you go for a lower frequency, the more problem is that if you go or shift towards the more lower frequency, so what will happen? Well, you know, till 300 megahertz, whatever the wave you are launching in the space, the ionosphere, it is acting as an umbrella and it will simply reflect back. Okay. Similarly, troposphere, it plays a significant role at the higher frequency range. Okay. And hence, you can see over here that, well, the radio frequency, radio wavelength is over here, or the microwave wavelength is over here, okay, which basically, you know, that where you can observe any kind of celestial objects over a wider spectrum. So this is the study of the universe at radio wavelengths. And in 1930s, it has started as an offshoot of development of radio communication technology. I will come to this story very soon. Yeah. So let me tell you that why it is required. Suppose you are, you know, that you can see. So you can see over here that, well, if the universe can be, you know, that can be observed at different wavelengths, one is making the some kind of imaging, right? And to make the image, what you need a particular receiver system which basically operates at the particular frequency. For example, if you want to detect a radio at radio wavelength or at microwave wavelength, so what you require some kind of, you know, that you require some kind of receivers, okay, that which operates at that particular frequency, okay. So, and thereafter you have to process it to form some kind of image of the distant object, okay. So you can see that our own Milky Way, it has been imaged at various wavelengths, and each of them are carrying some kind of, you know, that their individual characteristics, and as if there is no correlation between them, okay. After this, that let me tell you that what I was just telling you a few minutes ago, that how did this particular thing develop? So let me tell you the story of a scientist named as Karl Jansky, okay, who was basically a radio engineer from Bell Lab, USA. What he was doing, he was making some experiments in the field, and what he was doing that he was getting in his receiver some kind of, you know, some kind of extra peaks or additional peaks that which he had considered as spurious one initially. But once he had made some further study, what he was doing that he has found that, well, this peak is coming or arriving at certain interval of time. So basically what is happening, if you have, suppose, some kind of object like this way, from where if the radiation is coming from this end, now it is rotating around its axis and it is coming back to this location, and again it is emitting some kind of wavelengths, okay, and that has been received and accordingly processed after certain interval of time. So that's why that one is receiving this kind of signal, okay. And on the name of Jansky, okay, he is known, considered as the father of radio astronomy, okay. And there is one unit is there as one Jansky. I'm just writing Jan just to make this why, or some cases you can find in some of the literature, it is known as JKY. It has been written as 10 to the power minus 26 watt per meter square per hertz, that is power density per unit wavelength, okay. Accordingly, one can define it, okay. And let me tell you, in India also, radio astronomy had started in 1960s. So here was the some kind of imaging which has been done by a single dish radio telescope. You can see one telescope over here in Manchester, UK, and the person that whomsoever you can see over here in inset, okay. So he is Professor Mrinalkanti Dasgupta, who had worked in the erstwhile, you know, the Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics, okay. So he had walked over there and made this kind of beautiful image for making some kind of, you know, some, this is one of the contributions by him to make some kind of advanced research in the area of radio astronomy in India. And as the time goes up, okay, that what people had done, people later had gone for the array telescope. So what will happen that once you are making an array, you know, the antenna footprint gets enhanced. And if I consider the lambda or the operating wavelength constant, and so you know that resolution is basically lambda by d, okay? So if my d goes up or my antenna footprint goes up, so lambda by t will go down, and hence the resolving power that gets enhanced, okay? And the mastermind that who had made this kind of arrangement in India, he can see over here. Unfortunately, we lost him last year. His name is Professor Govind Swarup, considered as the father of radio astronomy in India. And just in fact, let me tell you that in his 90th birth anniversary, okay, one paper had come up. This has been, you know, it has been openly available literature. And you can see the title of this one is a tribute to Professor Govind Swarup, paper is the father of Indian radio astronomy. And if you read the abstract, what it has been written in this paper, we pay a tribute to the father of Indian radio astronomy, Professor Govind Swarup, okay, BSc, MSc, PhD, FRS, by celebrating his 90th birthday, occurred on 23rd March 2019, and recounting his remarkable scientific achievements in three disparate regions of the globe, the Indian subcontinent, Australia, and the United States of America, okay? So this was, in fact, you know that, and also I also feel lucky to get, you know, introduced with him, and I am just sharing a few moments that when he visited IIT Kanpur long back, when I was a PhD student and long back in 2011. And this was the one when I was visiting, you know, NCRA TIFR in Pune in 2013. And it is in his residence in 2016. And this is the last time when I met him in RC, Asia Pacific Radio Science Conference in New Delhi in 2019. Okay. So, yeah, so last year we lost him. That is a huge loss to the country. But you know that he couldn't witness this one, but you know that this is the third one which has been also accorded the IEEE milestone after the contributions of J.C. Bose and C.V. Raman. And these are some of the newspaper headings, okay, which has come up in the last November, December time. And you can see that this is the plaque which has been handed over to the GMRT authority. The GMRT, consisting of 30 antennas of 45 meter diameter each, spanning 25 kilometer near Pune, India, is one of the largest and most sensitive low frequency radio telescopes in the world, operating in 110 to 1460 megahertz. It pioneered new techniques in antenna design, receiver systems, and signal transport over optical fiber. GMRT has produced important discoveries in domains such as pulsars, supernovae, galaxies, quasars, and cosmology, greatly enhancing our understanding of the universe. Okay, especially I'm telling you to the students who are listening to this particular talk, if possible, please visit this particular facility situated 90 kilometers away from Pune, okay? And if you want to go over there, if you find some problem, please don't hesitate to contact me. I will give you the appropriate person to make a contact, okay? So now I'm entering into the more, you know, that the talk for which I have been invited for 2 days, okay? So I will tell about that. First, I will tell about some basics about metamaterials. Now, you know that, let me tell you like this way. Well, let me recollect this one. So you know that you have seen that those kind of observations you have to make, and you have to make certain images by making some kind of radio astronomical signals. Now, what you require in the receiver system, okay, it is nothing but, I can say in an easier term or in a simpler language, you already have, I believe that you have read the, you know, that super heterodyne receiver in your analog communication classes, okay, for demodulation of AM, right? So this is basically a variation, okay, or some kind of, I should say, an upgradation of the super heterodyne receiver, which has been used in any kind of radio astronomical detection, okay? Now the thing is that, well, in a super heterodyne receiver, what you have, you need an antenna, you need a filter, you need an absorber, you need a polarization converter, everything. Now, what is the purpose? Well, thing is that if you can make it in a, you know, that if you can make the things in a compact range, okay, or if you want to make a rugged system, okay. So what is the thing? The requirement is rugged, okay. Now, for that one, what you can do, that you can do that some kind of, you can use some kind of techniques or some kind of, you know, that structures, we call it metamaterials. This word meta, the word meta, it means beyond. Okay, so it is not that you are making some kind of materials which are not available. Well, what you are doing, you are making some kind of, you know, that some kind of structures, okay, which is basically homogeneous in nature, okay. And what you do, that you can consider like this way, you are having some kind of periodic structures, okay. And this periodicity, whenever excited by some kind of external waves or external signal, okay, it can basically exhibit some kind of unusual electromagnetic properties, okay. So you can consider, well, a basic meta atom, if you can see over here, that consists of an, you know, they are consist of an, it's some kind of, you know, that in atom is basically is a fundamental unit in an conventional material, whereas in kind of, you know, that meta material or meta atom, so here each meta atom, they are basically consisting of some kind of unit cells, okay. And how you are determining the unit cell? So unit cell dimension or the size is less than lambda by 4. And once in the language of, you know, that electromagnetics, this is known as effective homogeneity limit. Homogeneity limit. So what is the meaning of this one? Suppose you consider like this way. If the dimension of, you know, the dimension of a meta atom is lambda by 4. Let me give you an example. So in an area, if you consider an area, okay, a small area, basically suppose this is lambda and this is lambda. So how many will be there? You know that you will have some kind of, this is 4 over here, and this is also, we are having 4. So 4 plus 4, 16 number of elements, they are getting, in fact, you know, they are getting illuminated, okay, or they are getting, I can say that active whenever some wave is incident on it, right? Because you can consider the aperture dimension of the particular wave, okay? That is also lambda cross lambda, okay? Now, if you consider the size is lambda by 5, okay, or lambda by 6, so what will happen? 5 square or 25 number of cells will be illuminated, or 6 square, 36 number of cells will become illuminated. So accordingly, the numbers will change, okay? So what we can say that, well, that metamaterial basically goes for that, basically the thing is, that more you are using this kind of, you know, that the device compact by making that lowering in the dimension of the unit cell, what will happen? That you can have that maximum number of usage of the unit cells so that the more homogeneity property can be considered. It is not the individual element that's forward is coming into that one. Basically, it basically gives rise to an overall effect by having the mutual, you know, that I can say the mutual coupling effect among the neighboring unit cells, okay. So in fact, I will come to one example very soon in this particular talk, okay. So let me tell you that when first it has been started, this is an old diagram, a conventional diagram in the permittivity permeability curve, okay. You are basically taking the epsilon or the permittivity in the x side, while the y side is the permeability or the mu, and you are having that 4 different quadrants, and these quadrants will, we are well aware of, that is our conventional material. However, if I ask you that, well, I need a material, suppose epsilon value of 60 or mu value of 30, can you make it? No. So what you have to do? You have to apply certain, in this case, that what you have to do, suppose you want to have a metamaterial structure, what you are doing, the geometrical dimensions itself will provide some kind of, you know, that some kind of response from which you can retrieve the epsilon or mu value. I will come to that one very soon in this particular talk. Now, in the second or fourth quadrant, what you are having, either your epsilon is negative or your mu is negative. Now, if you consider this epsilon or mu, what we consider as the relative permittivity, the real part of that one is negative. So, you know that if I consider the refractive index, which can be defined as root over epsilon into mu, okay, and I can consider my epsilon equal to mod epsilon e to the power j theta, okay, and mu equal to mod mu e to the power j theta epsilon, I can say, and this is j theta mu, okay. Now what is happening in the normal case, whenever I don't have any kind of imaginary part, I don't have any kind of, you know, that any kind of imaginary part over here, I can consider by default my theta epsilon equal to theta mu, that is equal to zero, and hence my n is a real number. Okay. Now when you are having either of them as negative, so what will happen? This n will become imaginary in nature. You know that whenever the real value of n is existing, that means you are having the propagation. Okay. And whenever it is becoming imaginary, that means you are having the absorption. Okay. Whereas when both of them are negative, I can consider minus epsilon equal to, sorry, mod epsilon e to the power j pi, or minus mu, I can say it is mod mu e to the power j pi. Okay. So if I multiply the two, that is minus epsilon into minus mu, I can consider this is mod epsilon mod mu e to the power j 2 pi. And if I take the square root of that one, so square root of it, this one means that I can have it square root of epsilon into mu into e to the power j pi. That means this is minus of root over epsilon into mu. And that's exactly what you are having, that n is becoming minus epsilon into mu in this third quadrant. Okay. So this is known as the left-handed media. So people initially thought of, well, this can be our metamaterial structure. Okay. This is one of the metamaterial structure, but well, what you can do, you are making the structure, I am repeating it again, that once you are making the structure, you are making the periodic structure in such a way, so whenever the wave is incident on it, the properties of it gets perturbed, okay, and accordingly it gives rise to some kind of unusual electromagnetic properties, okay. So that may be in this region, that may be in this region, anything is possible, okay. So all the left-handed materials, they are metamaterials, but the reverse is not true, okay. This is one of the fundamental difference or one of the fundamental concept that will come into the picture, okay. Now, historically, you know that first, in fact, if you go as the mathematic point of view, Vassilakov was a Russian scientist who first predicted the existence of left-handed material, and minus epsilon or minus mu was, you know, that realized by Pendry in late 1990s, okay, and the left-handed media was first demonstrated by Smith, okay, and in fact, the negative refractive index was first realized by Shelby. And then, you know, the transmission line approach was given by Callows, and the resonant approach was also given by Martin. I am not going into the much historical overview over here, okay. Now, I'm telling you what is happening, that, well, how the negative permittivity, what is the, you know, that what was the thing? That if you are having some kind of metallic rods, okay, arranged in this one, yeah, they are cylindrical in nature, and if this is the periodicity and they have been oriented along Z direction, so what you have to consider, the periodicity is much less than lambda. If you are considering that one, one can show that epsilon effective can basically come to this particular one, okay? And accordingly, what you can do, that, well, you can see that that below a certain frequency, this epsilon effective is becoming negative in nature. This is the first demonstration of the negative epsilon, or negative permittivity. Similarly, if you are having, as you know, that an array of this kind of, you know, that some kind of metallic rings, okay, and if the magnetic field is perpendicular to the applied to this particular, you know, that set of this magnetic ones, so what you will have, you will have a, you know, that circulation of the current, that means you will basically generate some kind of LC resonant circuit, and accordingly you can find out some kind of, you know, that mu effective value, which also shows some kind of real and imaginary values. So basically you can see that one resonance is coming at this frequency, whereas the mu real in this region, okay, and mu imaginary, you can find out that it goes up in this one. So at this particular junction, basically what you are having here, the mu is becoming over a shorter distance or shorter frequency range, you are having the mu value is negative, okay, and yeah. So by combining these two approach, okay, you can see that, well, if you are having, you know, that's this resonating structure and this metallic rods, making a certain arrangement. So what you can find, well, initially, in fact, you know that there was a drop in this particular transmission because, you know, that metallic rods were on the only, you know, the split ring resonators were present. And once you were designing that epsilon negative at the same frequency range, so what you are having, simultaneously, you are achieving the epsilon negative and mu negative, which means that there will be some kind of transmission as we have seen just few slides ago. So what you can find out at the same frequency, you are having certain transmission, okay? And this can be also extended in the two-dimensional one. I am not going into much details. And here now I am coming to one of the interesting story. Suppose you are having, you know, already you know that whenever you are having some kind of refraction, you know what we do? That is N1 sine theta 1, already you know from Snell's law we can write it is equal to N2 sine theta 2. Okay. Now suppose this is for a conventional media, right? Now suppose my N2 is negative. So if my N2 is negative, so what will happen to counterbalance or to satisfy this equation? If N2 is negative, I have to make my theta 2 that should also be, it should be necessarily be negative to satisfy the Snell's law, right? So what will happen? That means that whenever to the instead of if you are making that way, as you know that it will move away from the normal, that whenever you are moving from the denser to the rarer medium, okay, the wave. So instead of this direction, it will follow the other direction. So let me just show you the example that which will be easier for you to detect. That well, that initially, in fact, you know that it is coming in this one, okay? But here, instead of this one, it is moving the theta 2 in the opposite direction. This is the consequence of the having the usage of metamaterial structures, okay, or the left-handed medium structures. Now you can see over here, let me just tell you an interesting example. Suppose we are having that here, these are one and this is, that is air media, and you are having a 1.3, okay, over here, that refractive index over here, that is a glass, okay. And once it is coming over here, so basically what you can have, well, you know that from it is coming from rarer to denser, and again denser to rarer, so there is no converging, okay, already it is diverging in nature. But suppose I am having, you know that within this air space, you are inserting some kind of left-handed media of refractive index minus one. So what will happen? Whatever the wave it is incident at the angle, so you are having that the equal angle on the other direction, it basically refracts, and essentially what you can have, you get some kind of additional focusing at some point. And again, when it is coming out from this one, you are getting another additional focusing over here, okay? So by using this kind of left-handed media, a diverging wave can be made converged, okay? This is one of the consequences of metamaterial, the focusing applications, okay? Further, in fact, let me tell you some other applications are also there. I am not going into details like super lens imaging, like antennas, cloaking, okay, the tunability. I will come some kind of antenna tunability application later. Cloaking application is very interesting. Suppose the wave is propagating from this is the transmitter side and this is the receiver side. If some obstacle is there, what you will see? You will detect this particular one, right? But suppose my obstacle is there and what you are doing, you are making some kind of boundary around it in such a way so that whenever the wave is coming, it basically, you know, that basically it goes past this particular medium and then it basically it propagates as if you are not detecting this particular one. So I hope that, in fact, since it's an Indian platform, let me tell you, I believe that many of you have watched the famous Bollywood movie, Mr. India, where the hero was becoming, you know, invisible at certain instant of time. So you can consider that is a kind of cloaking structure, right? The invisibility. The person is there, well, but the whenever it has been surrounded by some media, so you know that it has been, you know, that the wave is coming and basically surrounding the object and propagates normally, okay? So this is the some kind of, you know, some kind of the basics of these metamaterials. Now I am coming that what is why we are basically also, this is metamaterial. Nowadays the more convenient term is metastructure or the metasurface. So what is metasurface? It is nothing but a two-dimensional analog of the metamaterial. And it has been basically come from a frequency selective surface where you are having a two-dimensional array which can be made of some kind of metallic patches, some kind of metallic slots, some kind of other structures, okay? And basically what you are having, that the third dimension or the thickness of the structure is very thin in nature, okay? Very thin means I should say this is should be less than lambda by 10. You know that if you consider from the engineering aspects, that suppose you are having two dimensions, two quantities, x and y, and if you are making x is much greater than y, you know from engineering thumb rule design, we used to make x equal to 10y or x of the order of 10y. We used to make that one. Similarly, what we are having, the thickness is much lesser than lambda, and we can consider, well, that maybe something around 10t is nearly equal to lambda, or thickness is nearly lambda by 10. So whenever the structure is less than lambda by 10, we can consider, well, the structure is ultra thin in nature, okay? So this is basically the one which has been come up with this idea. And whenever you are having the periodicity, it operates in the sub-wavelength region. Already I have mentioned over here, sub-wavelength period, that is less than equal to lambda by 4, okay? We call it the structure is a metastructure or metasurface, okay? Now I am coming to different applications. I am starting with an absorbing application. So let me consider you from a very basic point of view. Suppose you are having an object. So whenever the wave is incident on this object, what will happen? A part of it will reflect back. A part of it will be transmitted, right? Now, how I will write it? I can write it, well, that if I consider some kind of lossy media, so what I will have? The rest of the wave that will become absorbed. So this is basically 1 minus S11 square. So those of you who are from the electronics background, you know, this is basically, I can consider this is my reflectivity R or reflected power R, and S21 square is nothing but my transmitted power T, okay? Now, if you are making a complete metallic backing means what? That you are having the transmission equal to zero. So basically you are having the absorption equal to 1 minus reflectivity. And as you can make this reflectivity to be smaller, okay? So basically what I can make that A equal to 1 minus R, and if, as my R will go down, okay, I can maximize my absorptivity. And one can make the input impedance of this particular medium. This can be in fact written from a conventional equation, which is very well known for the electromagnetics people. And when my S21 or my, you know, that the transmission coefficient becomes zero, one can write in this fashion, okay? Or S11 can be written like this. So what I have to make, that S11 equal to zero, or the reflection coefficient to be zero. So what I have to do for that one, I have to make my Z omega equal to eta naught. Okay, so the input impedance will become, you know, that is equal to the impedance of free space. And if you substitute it, so what it will become? This is eta naught into mu m I am writing by epsilon m, that is equal to eta naught. Okay, so what will happen? From this one, you can say that mu m equal to epsilon m. And if it consists of two real, this real part and imaginary part of both mu and epsilon, you will have them to be, you know, that they are mutually equal to each other, okay? Accordingly, once we go up, okay, you know that you can make a single band metasurface absorber in a very easier way. Well, this is the top view. On the other side, you are having the complete metallic structure. So what you are having certain metallic patches, okay? These are the dimensions which have been shown over here. It has been printed over a 1 millimeter thin FR4 dielectric substrate, okay? And what you can find out, the absorption is, you know, that is at 7.46 gigahertz, okay? So you can find out a structure like this way. Well, now the thing is, once you are scaling up the structure and down, scaling up or scaling down means what? The periodicity remaining constant, but the top metallic patches, okay? That particular one, if you just scale up that the dimensions of the structure, what will happen? As the dimension, you know, that as you increase the dimension, okay, basically what you will find, the frequency that gets, you know, that gets lower, or I can consider this one is, we can consider this to be rate shifted, because frequency goes down means wavelength increases. That means we call it rate shift, right? So basically you can call like this way. So here, this is the, you can consider like this way, this is the movement of K from the higher, lower value to the higher value. The scaling factor is K, right? So you can see from here, that is, you know, that is visible from this one also, okay? And what you can find out that, well, if you are having a scaling factor of 1, the thickness is lambda by 40, okay? Now with this particular concept, what you can do? You can make two subcells, okay? And these two subcells, one are identical and two are also identical to each other. So one have been scaled up by a factor 1.2, while the other has been scaled up by another factor 1.3. And you can make a simple dual band absorption, as simple as this one. Okay. Now, well, you have to experimentally validate the result. How you will do it? Well, you are making a structure like this way. And there, what you are doing, that you are making, this is the zoomed in view of this particular fabricated structure. you have been placed them in the anechoic chamber, okay? And you know that you are, this has been illuminated by a pair of horn antennas. And what you are doing, one of the antennas is, you know, that it's considered the transmitting one, the other one is receiving one. If you go the you know, the reverse way around, that is also fine. That is not a big deal. And what, but the most important thing is they should be identical. So whenever the wave is coming from this one, it is hitting the sample, okay? And the reflected one, it is intercepted by the other one. And you know that they have been connected to a vector network analyzer, okay? So what you can do, well, this is the, you know, that initially you have to take, well, whenever you are characterized this one, so initially you have to take a perfect reflector from which all the wave can get reflected, and that can be easily done if you consider any kind of metallic structure, right? So initially you take a copper surface of identical dimension, measure the reflection coefficient, then you keep the sample, again you measure the reflection coefficient, the difference between the two will provide you the actual reflection coefficient from the structure, okay? And accordingly, you can compute or you can determine what is the, you know, that what is the one from the other way around, okay? That is from the absorption coefficient you can determine. I can tell you another interesting one. Well, you are having two different resonating structure and you are merging them together like this way. And this provides, this also provides you some kind of dual band absorption. Now here I want to tell you one of the interesting story or one of the interesting fact. I was telling you some times earlier, well, the this basically provides you some kind of adjacent unit cell will also come into the picture. Well, you can notice it over here. When phi equal to 0 degree, that is whenever the electric field along this direction, it offers dual band absorption. Whereas when the field is along this direction, that is phi 90, you are getting an absorption at some another frequency, the third frequency, right? Now, if you measure these two, if you want to see the electric field along these three ones, well, you can find these gaps are becoming, you know, they are important. They are basically playing the major role. Here also the middle one is playing the major role. If you go over here, what you can find that, well, it is coming over here because this one, this unit cell is surrounded by the identical unit cells. So the metallic ones, the from this one to the neighboring one, that plays the, you know, that the important effect, that particular gap is coming into the picture. So accordingly, if you make, you know, that device like this way, structure like this way, where these subcells 1 and 2 are exactly identical, but rotated by 90 degree, you can basically determine or you can basically achieve a triple band structure as shown here, right? Now, what you can do, one can also make the retrieval of the electromagnetic properties from here. And what you can do if you go this particular calculation, the real and imaginary parts you can see, they are nearly equal at all these three absorption frequencies. I told you just a few minutes ago that metamaterial means, well, you are basically making or you are retrieving the electromagnetic properties from the device dimension because the device dimension will provide you some kind of responses. And from that particular responses, you can retrieve what is the, you know, that the concept of this particular, that, you know, that what is the particular concept of this, retrieve this the electromagnetic properties, okay? Now I am coming to, as I have told you at the beginning of this talk, that about the terahertz one. Now you know that if you learn, the, if you just see the history, so basically what was happening, people had gone up from, you know, one frequency band to another one, just in the higher frequency order in the electronic domain so that you can have more and more bandwidth, okay? On the other way, that some people were doing the researches in the optical domain, okay? Yeah, so, and what has been done that accordingly, that some gap has been come up, that which has been come up as the terahertz gap, okay? Now this one, what you can do, that this domain, that basically it takes the advantage from both electronic as well as from the photonic domain, okay? What you can have additionally, well, if you consider at 1 terahertz, the wavelength is 300 micron, and if you consider the associated energy, that is hc by lambda, that is around 4.1 milli electron volt, which is very small, right? So what can be the, you know, that what can be this one? So basically, if you consider, the radiation hazards are much lesser over here, but problem is, since it is in the gap, so neither in the electronic domain nor in the optical domain, so the most problem is the non-availability of the proper source or detector. Rather, you have to make certain, you know, that you have to make some kind of customization. And once you are doing the customization, you know, the price will also always go up, okay? So this is the one of the disadvantage at this section. Okay, but still people are using it because you can, you know, that people are now targeting for the 6G and 6.5G communication system. People are basically targeting this frequency band so that one can go with the more higher frequency, high bandwidth. Okay, So once you are coming to this one with the terahertz domain, so basically you can view this one. Well, here you can see that what you can do, suppose you see that gun has been loaded in this particular bag, or this person is carrying some knife beneath this newspaper, which can be easily detected, okay, by this this terahertz one. So the security system can be used, and it has been used for, in fact, even terahertz domain, you can also make some kind of observer. But well, one thing let me tell you, here all the materials, you have to follow the Drude model, okay? They are becoming dispersive in nature. Also, the dielectric substrate, they are also becoming dispersive in nature. So whenever you are modeling it, you have to take care this one into the account, and accordingly, one has to simulate the structure, okay? So this is one of the quad-band absorbers or some kind of broadband absorbers which can be achieved by this kind of structures. And also, I am showing you that what you can do, that if you want, you can basically model this structure by using some kind of time domain also, okay? So here you are having some kind of metallic structure at the top. These are dielectric and the metallic reflector at the bottom. And this has been, you know, the absorption is occurring at 0.28 micron, okay? Now the thing is, well, what you can do, that suppose you are increasing the thickness and increasing them to a value of lambda g by 2. And what you can find out, well, if you are making the dimensions, which have the dimension of this particular substrate, okay, that if you just increase by lambda g by 2, what you can find out, well, you are getting some kind of shifting. And in the time domain, one, from frequency to time domain, you know that multiple reflection, if you just convert it by making the inverse charges transformation, so you know that initially you can consider some wave is coming, it is getting reflected back, again it is going in this one, again coming out. So all these ones, so R12, the timing of the first reflected wave, that remains constant even if you increase the thickness. And that is exactly evident from this particular figure, okay? And you can, one can compute for a particular thickness, what are the timing of arrival, okay? You can find out from these ones, okay? So you can make a comparison with the simulated one and the numerically computed ones, okay? And now I am coming to another application of metasurface, which is known as polarization converter. Well, so till now what we have discussed, that wave will get absorbed. Now it, what will happen, the polarization will get converted. Polarization means what? The electric field direction with respect to time, okay? So there is a polarization converting structure. Here also the backside is completely copper backed, but here you are having the structure as shown over here. Now this is the fabricated one, the metallic one is something over here, you can see. This is the metallic structure, okay, that metallic patch which has been, you know, fabricated over the dielectric, and these are the dimensions, okay? And once you can simulate the structure, well, what you will get, that you will get that, you know, fabricated one, I'm just showing you, that here the transmitting and the receiving antenna, they have been in the same polarization for measuring the co-polarized reflection, while the cross-polarized reflection you can measure when one of the antenna is rotated with this by 90 degree with respect to the other one, okay? So what you can do accordingly, you can compute the co-polarized and cross-polarized reflection coefficient from which you can compute the, you know, the polarization conversion ratio, okay? Now also, you can also convert the linear to circular polarization conversion. So you can see the structure over here, the unit cell you can see over here, okay? This is a, it is again fabricated over the dielectric, okay? And here, what you can see that at different frequencies, if you draw the polarization ellipse, okay, they are following the circular one, and as you increase the incident angle till a certain value, you know that this one can be considered as a circular one from which it deviates the nature and following the elliptical path, okay? So here again, you can measure this one, and you have to, in this case, you have to measure both co-polarized, cross-polarized reflection, apart from which you also have to measure the phase difference. And once you will measure that, okay, and once you will, you know, that that makes some kind of computation in terms of axial ratio, okay, which basically provides you the nature of the circular polarization, you can find out below 3 dB, it operates over a wider range into frequency bands, okay? And the simulation and the experimental results, they vary. In fact, you know, there is a slight deviation due to the fabrication tolerances and other errors. Okay. Once you are doing this, okay, I am coming to another one in the terahertz range. Okay, so here you can well, the metallic strips are oriented along this direction and one end, and another one in the virtually orthogonal one. And electric field is oriented in the orthogonal direction with respect to the orientation of the metallic strip in the front surface. And the middle surface, okay, middle layer, it consists of some kind of asymmetric layer, you can see over here. And once it is having it, what you are having, this basically causes the polarization conversion, okay, as you can see over here, okay. And if you want to visualize it, you can see from one end, the you know that the electric field is oriented along this direction, while in the other end, electric field is coming in this direction. So you can say that, well, you are having a rotation, an orthogonal rotation of the electric field while transmitting through this particular structure. Okay. Once I go up, okay, also it is having the applications in the antenna. Okay, I can see some, I can show some kind of metasurface antenna. You can see that some kind of, you know, that some kind of array of cells which has been, you know, that which has been fabricated on the other sides of the patch and connected to the network analyzer, and again you are making the radiation patterns. Okay, and what you can do once you will do this, what you can find out by employing this kind of structure, you are having a dual band response and one of the bandwidth has been subsequently increased, and you can see the radiation patterns, you can the co and cross poles, in fact you can see the simulated and experimental results are in good matching, and co pole and cross pole response, they have been, you know, separated by a value of 20 dB. Okay. Accordingly, you can also consider that it can be.
I will request everyone to mute their mic.
Yeah. So what is happening that here this metasurface structure, it can be also make a sub kind of superstrate that is just over the patch, okay, and distance by, you know, that it has been made a spacing between them, and to make certain, you know, some kind of focusing application. So here you can say that, well, it is operating over a smaller bandwidth, but the gain has been enhanced as you can see from this particular responses, okay. And here you can see that, well, both the things have been achieved simultaneously with the gain enhancement as well as a dual band response of the operation of the antenna, okay. I have another interesting application towards the filter. So here you can see that in the terahertz domain, you know, this is basically the first order filter. First of all, I can show you that you are making a some kind of by, you know, that some kind of gold deposition and the metallic deposition on top of a silicon layer, okay, and both of them have been used, the have been modeled by using the Drude equation. What you can say that, well, you are having the transmission, the enhanced transmission, but once it is going the, you know, that in the cutoff region, it is not very much coming down, it is not very much sharp. So what has been done, that the second order and the third order one has come up, okay. So initially what has been done here, that you are making, I'm sorry for this one, so basically both of them are looking same. So here the this can consider this, if you are having a single one, you are having an air gap. With the three ones you are having, in fact basically this is the third order, okay, there are two air gaps. For the double one you are having a single air gap, okay. With the double layer and the triple layer according along with the single layer, what you can find out as you increase the number of layers, okay, what you can find that here the bandwidth has been enhanced in this region, okay, and also in this one you can have a sharper cutoff in this one and this one. You can increase the cutoff, okay, if you want, by having more number of layers, but the problem is you will lose the, you know, that the kind of compactness in the third dimension, okay. And also you can find the deflection coefficient on the other side, as you can see from this particular one, okay. Now as you obtain this particular case, so what you can do, I am showing you another interesting work. I am not going into much details, we have just started this work done by one of the BTech student over here in the last year. So what he has done, he had made an algorithm, okay, by having a binary search techniques. So what he has to do that, well, by that one, suppose the complete region of frequency, it has been divided into two space, the half in the left side, half in the right side. And once you are varying the dimension, you know that the resonant frequency of that will change. And accordingly, you can determine by making an binary search algorithm, okay, that what will be the value to simulate, and accordingly you can obtain the proper simulation, okay, from the proper frequency of operation of that particular filter. Okay, so this is one of the interesting applications which we have decided. I can also, I want to say something about this particular one, that is the some 2D materials known as graphene, okay. This can also be used in the metasurface applications for making some kind of tunability. What is graphene? You know, it's a two-dimensional monolayer of sp2 carbon atoms, okay. And what is that you are having? You are having the dynamic conductance or dynamic conductivity, okay. So once you will change the frequency, okay, that conductivity will change, which will provide you a change in the frequency response, okay. That is one of the application. And this basically provides you, this change of this conductivity will first give you a change in the Fermi level, which also changes the chemical potential and the structure, okay. So once you want to simulate this structure, you know that some graphene patches have been, you know, it has been deposited on top of a gold-backed silicon dioxide layer, yeah. And what you are having, that you are getting some kind of polarization conversion responses, as you can see from here. And once you can tune these particular chemical potential values, you are having the tunability of this particular response, okay. Further, what you can have, well, you are making another dimension, and here you can have the linear to circular polarization conversion. You can see the results over here, and you are getting the axial ratio below 3 dB at three distinct frequency points. So instead of graphene, if you are using the conventional patch of gold, okay, what you will get, you are, first of all, you are getting that only a dip of air, of axial ratio at a certain frequency, but still it is not below 3 dB, and hence you cannot say it, you know, that a circularly polarized wave. Okay. Also, it can be contributed towards the broadband absorption, as you can see from here. Here is the graphene layer, okay, it's the silicon acid substrate and the metal layer on the other side, and you are getting some kind of broadband absorption. So this one can also be made tunable by changing the chemical potential. I am not going into further details. And also, yeah, what you can do over here, you can make all graphene based metasurface structure, the top and bottom layers both can be used as graphene, okay. And what you can do, that you can make that both the layers you can tune simultaneously, okay, so that you can have the tunability of the band. And what you can do, that those two graphene layers, they have been biased at two different frequencies. This is a conventional way, or I can say that a schematic way of this kind of biasing. And here, this can, what you can do by making this kind of biasing, you can, you know, that activate the graphene layer accordingly. Okay. So this is the tunability of the band. So this one we consider, okay. And I finally want to tell you some kind of pixel-based approach, which is kind of new development in this area. So here, what is happening, the complete metasurface meta-atom structure, okay, it has been divided into several pixels. Some of them are patched by one material, some of them by the patched by another material, and some of them have been left out unpatched, okay. Once you are making it, so basically you can basically offer some kind of multifunctionality. So basically, what is that doing now? Suppose if you were allowing some kind of, you know, external magnetic field, if you were, it has been exposed into, okay. So what you can observe, you can observe some kind of shift over here. And what you can see further, well, if you are having these different meta atoms combination, you can see from this stage to final one, once you are changing it, you know, at two different values of magnetic field, when no field has been applied and one 0.8 Tesla field has been applied, if you see these two ones, what you can see, that you are making some kind of, you know, you are having certain differences. And here you can see in the seventh case, or whenever you are have given the final design, you are getting that, you know, that most you can get the widest tuning range that can be achieved at this particular configuration, okay. So basically you can make the pixelated meta-atom structure, that where you can achieve the multifunctionality or multi-controllability, okay. So this is the one which I want to highlight over here. Now, before I end up the talk, this particular talk, I want to acknowledge a few students that who had worked with me. I want to show you some of the photographs of the summer interns who had worked with me in 18 and 19. Last year, unfortunately, no one can turn up over here due to the pandemic. And this year, some of them are still working, but let them come up with some work, after which I will put their photograph over here. And I also want to acknowledge that my students that who had worked with me, the some bachelor student, one master, some few, a few master students that who had worked with me and who had already graduated with me, okay? A few PhD students that who had graduated with me, and few of them are still working, okay? And some of the collaborators, in fact, some of the students who are working from some other institutions. Also, I am indebted to my institute for some kind of support and all the infrastructure and financial support, and a CRB for some kind of partial support of our, the development of our research lab. Before I end up, I also want to show that my the pictures of my the photographs of my collaborators whom I have indebted to. Okay, they had worked beautifully. Okay, and we are working and we are coming up with some kind of, you know, some kind of making some kind of interesting results. Okay, and before I end up, well, our campus is there in Varanasi, and we are having a beautiful temple within this particular campus, a Lord Vishwanath temple. This is not the conventional Vishwanath temple for which Varanasi is famous for. This is another one that, but this is a new one and beautiful one within the campus, separating out the BHU and IIT BHU area mostly. Okay, and well, so you are most welcome to visit our campus once the things are much will be in a much better shape. And thanks very much for to all of you. These are, in fact, I am just sharing my email ID, and you can browse my website for more information. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Somar Bhattacharya, for this wonderful talk. Now I will request Harni to take up a few questions, if there is.
Thank you so much, sir, for this interesting and very intriguing talk. May I request the audience to put up their questions if they have any for sir? You may raise your hand and you can come up with the questions that you would like to ask.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, could you call frequency selective surface as a metamaterial?
Please repeat. I couldn't listen to you properly.
Could we call FSS as a metamaterial?
Well, let me go back to that slide and try to explain you. FSS is basically a frequency selective surface in a two dimension. Okay, first of all. Secondly, it can be a metasurface. There should be two things. First of all, that third dimension or the thickness should be less than lambda by 10. As I have mentioned over here, okay? And secondly, when the FSS structure, the periodicity is less than lambda by 4, satisfying the effective homogeneity condition, then only we can call it a metasurface. Are you getting my point?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, sir. Any other questions? I guess one by Mr. Piyush Kumar Mishra.
Yeah.
So,
hi,
hello.
Yeah.
Hi, sir. Such yeah, a very informative session. Thank you very much, sir. And I really appreciate to organizers also for organizing this event. Sir, my question is, sir, how can we increase the gain of antenna by using the meta surface?
Well, one of the application is, well, let me, I don't forget my this one. No. One of the application is by using this kind of superstrate layer. Okay, so what you are having this patch over here, you can see, okay, and over to this patch you are having a Teflon layer, okay, and you are developing a metasurface layer. So basically you are having more focusing, okay, or more gain. So this is one of the way to enhance the gain. Okay, another way is that, well, you can make this kind of, you know, metasurface design along the patch itself, so that by, you know, with the mutual coupling also, you are having the enhancement of the gain, which you can have in this other case. Yes.
Okay. Sir, one more question. Hello?
Yeah, please.
Yes. Sir, how we can decide the shape of units? Means how we can decide the shape of units then? Well, and can we one more, sir? Can we use this meta surface in the biomedical field?
Yeah. First of all, let me give you one by one shape of the unit cell. Well, first of all, you should choose the geometry in such a way so that you will have the perimeter of the structure is the lambda by 2. Perimeter. I am not talking about periodicity. The perimeter. Okay. Now, once you are making it, you know that we now you have to play with the geometrical size and dimension within that lambda by 2 in such a way so that you can have the more compact structure. Okay, this is number one. Number two is that what I was just what you were talking about, the biomedical one. Yes, you can do. In fact, I have not shown it one of our results. Okay, we had achieved a couple of years earlier one of the initial results. So there we have shown that by having having some kind of wearable device on this antenna or wearable antenna, what you can have, you are having the gain enhancement in one direction. But that case, whenever you are designing, you should make sure in the other end or in the back side, the gain is significantly lower.
May I request the audience to mute their mics? It's causing a lot of trouble. Thank you so much. So please, sorry for the disturbance.
No, it's okay. So what you are making that, yes, in this direction, you can have the radiation, there is no issue. But on the other direction, if there is significant radiation, then it will affect your tissues and your bones. So you should be very, very much particular that you should not have sufficient back radiation. Am I gettable, Piyush?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sir, one more last question. Can we use the meta surface directly on the patch surface, or we have to provide some medium between them?
One can use. In fact, that's what you can see over here. This is the patch, and over here the meta surface has been. In fact, it has been loaded. You can see on the same.
No,
side.
Sir. Yes, sir. We can use directly as a superstate on the top of surface of patch.
Yeah, the superstate is this one. Superstate, well, the superstate means the patch and the other layer, they are different layers. Between them, there is a spacer, okay? And here what I am talking of, okay, that here it is in the same surface of the patch.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions from the audience?
Audience, do we have any other questions?
Am I audible?
Yes, yeah. Yes, you're audible.
Yes.
So Kant from IIT Mandi.
Sorry, hello.
Hi, yes, sir. Am I audible properly?
Yes, I am audible. Yeah, you are audible. Yeah.
Okay, Somak, this is Shrikant from IIT Mandi.
Oh, hi.
It's a very nice presentation. I have one question regarding this polarizer or in general, this metasurface structure. So when you said that regarding the theory of unit cell, I had small observation which I did in my own experimentation that when you illuminate it, like as I could see in your that polarization converter where you have used curves, like periodic curves, which are, yeah. So the periodicity is different along X and Y axis. Like if I take the surface, X and Y axis, the nature of unit cell, if a wave is illuminated from the incident, like if you incident a wave on that, so the wave might see a different periodicity or different structural geometry along X and Y axis. So does that have any effect in terms of its performance as a polarization converter or in the sense of absorbers?
You are talking of that, that if you don't have this two-dimensional symmetry, that one you are talking of. I am not getting your question properly.
Two-dimensional symmetry. Like if I take, say, along x-axis, you will, like for example, this slide, if you see, along x-axis, there is a different periodicity, and along y-axis, the symmetry is different.
No, periodicity is symmetric. It is also symmetric in the x and y dimensions, if you notice. If you make a diagonal, okay, then if you just wrap it up, so on both the sides it's having the equal side. If you are having a four-fold symmetric, then it will be polarization independent structure. But once you are having the two-fold symmetric, okay, So basically you are making the some kind of chiral geometry, okay, that one is comes into the picture, and that makes the structure to be polarization converting structures.
Okay. So do you see any effect of this twofold and fourfold symmetries in terms of absorption also?
Yeah, obviously. In fact, we have seen that. I have not shown it over in this presentation, but yes. In fact, if you read any of our papers on those topics, you will find we used to show.
Okay. Thanks. That's all from my side.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Do we have any other questions?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, hello.
Sir, could you use FSS for bandwidth enhancement to get a super wideband characteristics?
Yes, obviously. Actually, by default, FSS structure will provide you a very narrow band structure, okay? Because they are basically resonating in nature, and resonance means, you know, that once you are considering a simple LC resonance, so basically the Q will be very high, the bandwidth is narrow, okay? And now you have to play with the structural dimension as well as the other ones so that you can get a wideband response. For example, if you consider this one, suppose if you consider the graphene-based structures, okay? So here you are getting, if you see, it's a wideband configuration. This one, or if you consider this absorbing structure, or this one, okay, here you are getting a very wide absorption bandwidth. Hello, am I getable?
With a general metallic element, sir, that's what I mean.
If you consider simple metallic element, you will get a narrow band response. But then you have to play in such a way so that you should get a broader response. For example, let me show you. I can show you over here. Here, what you are having, you are having some kind of metallic patches in such a way. Well, you are using in the single unit cell. And thus, although it is compact in nature, but still what you are getting wideband response.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, sir.
This metallic element as a FSS, simply it is possible for high gain only, sir. It may be unidirectional or bidirectional. Other than that, no other feature, sir.
I'm not getting. Please repeat.
If you use metallic FSS, mm-hmm. As a superstate or substrate, it is possible to enhance only the directivity, sir. Gain that and all. No.
So gain as well as bandwidth. In fact, that's what I have just shown you. Just 1 minute. You can see from here the bandwidth has been increased, because you can see the bandwidth of operation is this one. This is my bandwidth of operation in this band. Okay. I can see over here. Okay. So now, and once you are going in this one, in the other case, what you can see that here, the bandwidth here, if you consider, the bandwidth is narrow while the gain has gone up.
Yes, sir. Sir, can we replace FSS with simply a metal functionality?
Well, metal, in fact, what will happen once you will, if you replace FSS with a complete metal one, what will happen if you consider a metal, it's a reflector, right? So basically, whenever the wave is incident on it will be reflected back.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Ma'am, do we have any questions from your end? Mr. Ghosh.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Hi.
Yes, sorry, Shomong. Congratulations, Shomong. Thank you. It was a nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, I have this much to say because I've heard you earlier and you explained it fantastically well.
Yeah. Sir, I will be very happy to receive some comments from you, if you have any, regarding this one.
Well, keep up the good job. You know, that's the only comment I would have for you. You've been publishing well, and you
know what I am asking, that what the audience is talking of about this. This, in fact, the previous person who was asking the question, since you know you are one of the pioneers in this field, so there's this kind of superstate effect you can explain much better than me, I believe.
No. you know, like so much of optics, and there's so much of integration of optics and in microwave domain, you know, you can literally integrate them, because if you know the fundamentals of electromagnetics, right?
Yes.
So, because everything can be translated into plasmonics, explained with plasmonics too.
Mm-hmm.
Like even the Huygens metasurfaces. Are you doing anything on Huygens metasurfaces?
I have not started anything right now, but I am in a plan.
Because you can go through the work of George Eletri at this University of Toronto.
Okay.
Because okay. They are doing a lot of, this is basically all can be terminated to phase engineering, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This is another terminology, can be phase engineering, and it's kind of phase engineering. If you can collimate the beam, you can enhance the gain.
Okay, yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I'm sure this is a very, you know, like new areas, very vibrant research domain. And this has, you know, huge potential. Yeah, so that, you know, those will be my comments. And thank you for this nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. I hope Dr. Bhattacharya would be pleased to have comments by his mentor and his guide. So with this, we come to the end of the technical lecture. May I request Dr. K.K. Singh, sir, for the vote of thanks?
Yes, thank you, Arneet. We have so many guests who were attending these lectures, Professor J.S. and Dr. O.P. Singh, sir, who is PhD from RTBHU and working in the field of microwave. We have Professor Manish, we have Dr. Sachin, Professor Vivek. To name few, Dr. Varun Kakar is there. So it was a nice talk, purely technical talk, and it was really interesting, opening the minds to work in the area. Those who are working, they have their doubts. That doubt was clear. And I will request Professor Varun Kakar to officially give vote of thanks, who is also the organizer of this event. He's a chair, IEEE Young Professional in UP section. Professor Varun Kakar, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Arneet. Thank you, Dr. Kamlesh. Thank you, Dr. Somak Bhattacharya, sir. I am very thankful to Dr. Somak Bhattacharya, sir, that he brought out some time from his busy schedule for this lecture. Actually, we were planning this lecture for a very long time, and we were in continuous touch with Dr. Somak Bhattacharya. But due to some unavoidable circumstances, and as per the suggestions of IEEE UP section and IEEE Young Professionals Committee UP section, we thought of starting a new technical lecture series and professional lecture series. So this is the second lecture from this technical and professional lecture series. The first lecture was delivered by Dr. Sumit Suman from Ericsson, and this was the second data. And thank you, Dr. Suman, for this excellent and very informative session. Thank you, Dr. Suman Bhattacharya. I am also very thankful to IEEE UP section, especially its chairman, Dr. Satish Kumar, especially Dr. Satish Kumar Singh, who is a continuous source of motivation, not for us, but for the whole section and for all the committees of the IEEE UP section. As this event, this technical lecture series and professional lecture series is supported by IEEE Young Professionals Reason 10 and IEEE Reason 10. So I, on behalf of the IEEE UP section and the Young Professionals Committee IEEE UP section, I am very thankful to IEEE Young Professionals Reason 10 and IEEE Reason 10 that they are supporting this particular event and lecture series. So once again, thank you all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir.
I will request all the attendees, guests, to please switch on their camera so that we can have a few photographs as a memory for this lecture.
Sir, actually, I forgot to mention one thing. that yes, Dr. Sonu Bhattacharya is a very active IEEE member. And he, who is generally involved in various IEEE activities from time to time at his institute and at the section level. Dr. Somak is also the recipient of IEEE Young Professionals Star of the Month from IEEE UP section. I forgot to mention these things.
It's okay.
Let me have. Harneet, you can also take your photographs.
Yes, sir, I've already taken.
Yes. All of you, please smile. We can have a nice, memorable photograph. Once again, thank you very much, all of you, especially Professor Somak, Dr. Varun, and all my teammates from IEEE AUP Lucknow campus, all the faculty from ASET, all my students and the delegates from international fraternity and all over from India. Dr. Saifur Rahman, Namaskar, welcome.
Thank you very much, sir. Really, it was a very nice lecture, and I am very grateful that you have invited me also to attend. You have given me that invitation today, and I was just wondering that whether I can attend or not. So I just arranged my lecture to attend this lecture. So it was a really very nice lecture, and I am very thankful to you and to the sir also for giving a very nice lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Saifur Rahman. Thank you for sparing the time.
Thank you, sir. So we look forward to having more technical lectures with all the esteemed members of the IEEE from both the Indian and the international domain. Thank you so much, Dr. Bhattacharya. We look forward to having more lectures from you and widening our horizon of knowledge. So with your due permission, may we conclude the meeting?
Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you,
thank
everyone.
With this, we come to the end of
I am leaving. Yeah, thank you.